My name is Victor Furman. Some call me The Voice. I've always been fascinated with human nature, spirituality, science, and the crossroads at which they meet. Join me now and we will explore these topics and so much more with fascinating guests, authors, and experts who will guide us to Destination Unlimited. In ancient times, before the Abrahamic monotheistic religions, there was a deep, heartfelt desire to commune with the divine, to become one with the gods, and earn their favor and blessings. Our guest this evening, Brandy Williams, shares that this path, called Theurgy, thrives today and wants to share her more than 25 years of research and practice with those who seek this knowledge. Brandy is a ceremonial magician and founder and director of the Seattle Pagan Scholars. She served as president of Covenant of the Goddess and maintains involvement with Ordo Templi Orientis and the Temple of Light and Darkness. She's also the author of Practical Magic for Beginners, The Woman Magician, and she joins us this evening to discuss her latest book, For the Love of the Gods, The History and Modern Practice of Theurgy. Please welcome Brandy Williams. Good evening, Brandy.
Good evening, Victor. Thank you so much for having me.
Well, thank you for joining us tonight. So let's start with your path. Please share with our listeners how you first became interested in ceremonial magic and pagan practice.
Well, I was raised Catholic, and when I was a teenager, I kind of felt a call to the priesthood, and I discovered that Catholic priests had to be men, so it wasn't a path that could call to me, and I began to look at what I could do as a woman, and witchcraft was something that kind of crossed my horizon, and I immediately felt a connection as a witch. I was one of those people who felt that I had come home, that I had been a witch before. Mm. And so I began to study witchcraft as a 17-year-old reading books under my covers at night. And that was how I got started.
A lot of people in pagan practice started that way, reading those books, taking them out from the library or buying them at local esoteric bookstores. Do you find that?
Yes, absolutely. I find that. I find a lot of people have started in that way. Although now I'm old enough that I'm meeting people like Lasara who were raised as pagans in their family. So we're getting a second and even third generation now, which is very exciting.
Absolutely. Now, how do you define magic and ceremonial magic?
Well, magic is a really big term. There are a lot of definitions. I know academic definitions. Magic is an umbrella term in sort of practical use for a lot of communities, hundreds and hundreds of communities. Ceremonial magic is a specific thing. It's a Western tradition. It's European based, and it's right in the thing that we're talking about now, which is theurgy. It comes from this sort of underlay of esoteric practice that's our inheritance in the West. Ceremonial magic is based in the exact tradition that we're discussing today, this very ancient tradition that goes back a couple of thousand years. And ceremonial is specifically about ritual, about doing ritual that moves you forward in your life. So it's a very specific tradition as opposed to magic, which is a really broad term.
So let's sort of define magic first, though. I think listeners who are not familiar with this, how do you define magic? Let's go. It's okay to be broad about it. Just how do you define it?
You know, because I'm a Thelemite, because I'm a follower of Aleister Crowley, his definition always pops into your head, the art and science of making change in conformance with will, which means that magic gives you an understanding of how the world works, and you can use that understanding to make things happen in your life and in other people's lives.
So it's using your will, your conscious desire to motivate and move the energy that exists and permeates everything.
That's really a good way to put it, yes. And your will coupled with your understanding, with your knowledge of how the world is set up on a very subtle level.
Absolutely. And then ceremonial magic takes that one step further by applying ritual to the practice.
Yes, and very specific ritual which creates a miniature cosmos that you can then step into and move. And as you move that miniature cosmos, things happen in your life, and also things happen in the world.
Absolutely. Now, what is the definition of theurgy?
Theurgy is often translated as God work. It's the work that we do with the gods and the work that the gods do with us. So we're now in the territory of paganism, where we understand that there are deities and there are multiple deities called gods. They're male, female, and envisioned in many ways. And theurgy brings us in relationship with those entities.
Okay. Now, how did you become interested in theurgy?
Well, I'm a history geek, and I would go to the library and learn things about pagan religion. Many of us who are in the pagan religions now and are called to the work of the gods, we have a disconnect with our past. We're raised in secular culture. Like me, we're raised in other religions, like the Catholic religion in my case. And so we learn about paganism largely from the works of scholars, from academics who tell us how paganism was practiced by our people in the past or by other people. And I would go to the library and read things that were very different from my current practice. And then I picked up a book that looked very much like my practice. I understood it. I understood how it worked. I understood how it built the cosmos and how to work the rituals. And it was 2,000 years old. The Greek Magical Papyri in translation is the book. And it's a collection of Egyptian and Greek texts that are called spells with quotes that are really rituals that do things for people. They help you move forward in your life. They call lovers. They do healing. And they bring you in touch with the gods. And I was just fascinated by this. Why is it that I can take this really, really old text and I can do it today? And so I started trying to connect the dots and figure out what it was that this thing was. And it turned out theurgy is a great word to describe it.
And let's talk a little bit about those ancient Greek and Egyptian, because that seems to be the foundation of all of this, is it not?
Yes. Theurgy comes from the Platonic philosophers. Another definition of theurgy is that it is the ritual system that was practiced by the Platonic philosophers at the end of antiquity. So when the Roman emperors converted to Christianity and decided to close down public pagan worship, they closed the pagan temples, but they also closed the schools. They closed the academies in Athens and in Alexandria. And this was where the Platonic philosophers were teaching philosophy. But at the end of antiquity, they saw this happening. They saw that the way of the gods was being lost. And they felt very much a sense that they wanted to keep that connection, to keep that knowledge alive. And they were it was their responsibility to do this. And so theurgy is a ritual way that they expressed that in their lives and built it into the works that they wrote that we can still read and we can still do those exact things that they did.
And how does this tie in to what was known as the Hermetic tradition?
The Hermetic tradition really comes off of it. So the Hermetic tradition is both the philosophy or theology, the theory that's based, grounded in Platonic philosophy, and the practice, which is that ritual piece. And those two things got separated in antiquity as the Roman culture closed down open pagan culture, as it became not possible to do out in public. You could practice in private and still study philosophy in public. So they got kind of separated. We're bringing them back together today, which is part of the task of the contemporary theurgists.
And the ancient Egyptian foundation seems to be predates all of this, correct?
And the Platonic philosophers themselves pointed to Egypt as the source of their tradition. And they visited Egypt. They say to us that they went to Egypt and they learned in the universities there.
Go ahead,
Are you still there?
Yes,
No worries. They learned from the universities there, and they studied in Alexandria, which is a city in Egypt. Even though it was a Greek city, it was still in Egypt. So they could go up country and go study at the temples. So yes, definitely the tradition comes from Egypt, and it's one of those hoary canards, right, in esoteric times in esoteric life that we come from Egypt. But it turns out to be literally true. Our tradition stems from the temple practices in Egypt, and then it funnels through the Platonic philosophers to come to us today.
And some of those, the Library of Alexandria was known as the center of this amazing knowledge.
It was, and it wasn't just about books. We think of the library and we think of the burning of the library. It turned out to be a very large precinct with scrolls and with statues and that sort of thing. But it was also a place where people went to teach. Every morning, a priest would come out, a priest of the muses would come out, do an invocation and invoke the muses, and then the teachers would get started talking to their students.
It was a tremendous loss when the library was burned, wasn't it?
It was. I mean, if I it's that thing. If I had a time machine, that would be the one place I would go. Like, as many scrolls as you can, load them up, right?
Absolutely. Tremendous knowledge, and thank goodness that some of it has been preserved and handed down by people, by scholars, and people like yourself.
Yeah, I really feel that very strongly, that we have to push the knowledge forward every generation. Each of us is responsible for doing that.
That all knowledge should be shared and handed down, because any knowledge that's abrupted is a loss to all of humanity.
Oh, yeah. And a really good example of that is the Chaldean Oracles, which is one of the foundational texts for Theurgy. The last person who had a complete copy of the Chaldean Oracles was Pletho, Georgius Gemistus Plethon. We have fragments that we've recovered from quotes other writers gave, and we've put it back together, but we don't have the complete text. And the really funny thing about the Chaldean Oracles is that they keep going in and out of print. So the current translation is Ruth Madrichik's Chaldean Oracles, and it was out of print for a period of 5 years while I've been doing this work, and it's been brought back into print again. So you really just have to grab that knowledge and keep on teaching it and keep on printing it and pushing it forward.
My guest this evening is Brandy Williams. She's author of the new book, For the Love of the Gods. And we'll be back with Brandy and more on the concept of theurgy after these messages on the OMTimes radio network.
OMTimes magazine is one of the leading online content providers of positivity, wellness, and personal empowerment. A philanthropic organization, their net proceeds are funneled to support worldwide charity initiatives via Humanity Healing International. Through their commitment to creating community and providing conscious content, they aspire to uplift humanity on a global scale. OMTimes, co-creating a more conscious lifestyle.
Hello! Join us, Lisa Berry and Michelle Carter, every Monday at 1 p.m. Eastern Time for the Mindset Makeover, What's Possible? Get ready to become present, clear, and unstuck, and start living fully, led by your heart. While you listen and feel this transformation through vibration of word, sound, and song, you'll open up to what's possible and experience your shift.
It only takes a minute to find out if you may have prediabetes, and you can do it at doihaveprediabetes.org. But you're probably not going to, are you? Kids, work, listening to the radio. You're busy, which is great because busy people can't get prediabetes. Oh my, I read that wrong. They can. Should have worn my glasses. So visit doihaveprediabetes.org and take a short test, because prediabetes can be reversed.
Brought to you by the Ad Council and its Prediabetes Awareness Partners.
In the small town of Elmira, New York, a boy was born into an all-American family. The odds of him achieving his dream in the fashion industry? 1 in 23 million. The odds of having a child diagnosed with autism? 1 in 68. I am Tommy Hilfiger, and my family is affected by autism. Learn more at autismspeaks.org/signs. Brought to you by Autism Speaks and the Ad Council.
Hi, this is Bill Maher. I can find humor in almost anything, but one thing I never laugh about is cruelty to animals. If you don't get the joke either, write People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals, 501 Front Street, Norfolk, Virginia, 23510.
And we're back on Destination Unlimited. My guest this evening is Brandy Williams, author of the new Llewellyn book, For the Love of the Gods, The History and Modern Practice of Theurgy. And one of our guests from a couple of months ago, LaSara Firefox Allen, who wrote Jailbreaking the Goddess, had this to say about Brandy's book. She says, in For the Love of the Gods, Brandy Williams brings teachers, gods, ancestors, and guides to life. Williams writes with such love and devotion that it's easy to come present in stories of our collective ancient history. When it comes to practice, Williams offers both academic rigor and grounded accessibility, which is an amazing balance to achieve. The foremost theurgist and woman magician, Williams offers us a magical history peopled by powerful women teachers, ancestors, and gods. The book is a gift of love and a rousing love song to past, present, and future generations of women magicians. What a wonderful review.
Oh, thank you so much. And I have to say, I don't think of myself as the foremost theurgist. There are people who have been doing this for longer than me who I have learned from. But it's lovely of Lasara to say that. It's lovely, yeah.
You know what? We've all had teachers and predecessors and ancestors who've gathered and passed on knowledge. And each generation has a champion that takes that knowledge and runs with it and brings it to the next generation. And I think that's what she was acknowledging in you.
I really appreciate that. And I want to hasten to add, too, that I have written a book called The Woman Magician. So Lasara was saying women magicians, but I'm hoping that men read this book as well.
Absolutely. Now, what does it mean to love the gods?
You know, many of us are called to the gods, called to a sense of needing to have a connection with them. That's how we become pagan in the first place, I think. And so loving the gods for theurgists, ancient and modern, rests on a base of devotional practice. Often the gods that we're talking about are the Greek gods, the Olympians, and sometimes the Kemetic gods as well. But any god can fit into the system. The ancients would go and travel and pick up new gods and bring them home, right? So we have a devotional practice where we build altars and we put a statue or some image on that altar and then begin to make offerings. And then theurgy takes that one additional step. So with the theurgic practice, the rituals call the gods into ourselves, and then they allow us to rise to the realm of the gods and meet them in their own homes. So that's the theurgic step.
Talk a little bit about that. What is that like?
Well, it is something that you spend some time learning how to do. The practice of philosophy involves in this sense, involves the practice of meditation to still the mind. So something that's important is that if you're going to rise on the plains and visit the gods, you have to stop the chatter in your mind and then learn how to close your physical eyes and open the eyes of the soul so that you can see the gods themselves. And that's a term that the theurgists use, is eyes of the soul. So it's like when you call the god into yourself, your body is the temple, and you're looking at the god in that body. When you rise on the plains, you're looking with the eyes of the soul and at the realm that the gods exist in.
And in doing so, what do you achieve?
Communion, the sense of being with a presence, being with a divine presence, and that makes changes in you. That makes changes in your physical body. It makes changes in the body of the soul. There's a body of the soul in the system, and it makes changes in how you think about the world. It's like being in the presence of somebody that you admire, somebody who's holy. That will change you as well. It changes your aura, your sense of self, and there's that sort of, it's difficult to say, we're in that place where words start to fail you. It's ineffable. Right. We invent words like ineffable to describe that experience, right?
And it's kind of like the concept of being in the presence of the great teacher and mm-hmm. taking on both the knowledge of the teacher and the attributes of the teacher that you admire, that you resonate with, and then running with them.
Yeah, and it's really interesting that you mention that, too, because that's how theurgy has been taught or practiced. It was among the ancients. There were teachers who gave you this knowledge, both the philosophy, the theory, and the ritual, the practice. And people really looked up to those teachers. They thought of them as holy. They maintained relationships with them their whole life. They really loved their teachers. And so that's something that's very important in this tradition. And part of what I do in the book is to tell stories of these teachers so that we can have some experience of learning from them as well.
Would you share one of those with us, please?
A story? Oh, let's see. Well, there was Plotinus, and he was a man who went to Alexandria, to the Library of Alexandria, to find a teacher. And he was kind of starting to think, he would go every day to the Library of Alexandria and he would watch the teachers talking. And it seemed to him like they were all interested in hearing just the sound of their own voice. And he was beginning to think that he was kind of being picky. But then one day he saw a man sitting on the steps who seemed unperturbed by anything that happened to him. There were other people that were walking down the street and they bumped into this guy and said, "Hey, Sacchus, get out of my way." And the man didn't seem to react to this at all. So Plotinus sat down next to him and said, "Well, listen, why didn't that bother you? You know, it seems like you're very serene. And the man said, well, I am one with the spirit. And when I'm one with the spirit, what does it matter if somebody bumps me on the street? So Plotinus took him on as a teacher and learned from him. And he studied with him for 13 years. So, wonderful. And I love Plotinus too. He was my favorite, I think, in many ways, because he was a genuinely good man. He was a man who, he ended up in Rome later, and he took on the orphans of his students. So he would raise them and make sure that their money was taken care of. And people really genuinely loved this man. And I kind of take him as a guide, an example for my work as well, to try to be as good to other people as I can.
Wonderful. And the essence that I'm taking from this from you is that someone in practice finds wholeness within themselves and then can extend that wholeness in the form of kindness, compassion, and knowledge to others.
I really think so. I really think that that's what a spiritual tradition ought to do. And I think that this is my tradition. Many people find that in many ways. Right now, I'm involved a lot in the world in social justice work. And I spend a lot of time in the company of Christians because it's very important in the Christian churches. Black churches are where the social justice movement is really rooted. So I spend a lot of time with Christians, and they have that sense of spirituality as well. So I think wherever it is we find it, that's what spirituality should do. It connects us with each other, and we connect with each other to try to make the world better.
Do you find your path and practice a challenge in working with and being accepted by people of Christian or Jewish or Islamic faith?
You know, it was something when I first went to a meeting where we all said what we were, I had to take a deep breath as I'm sitting next to an Episcopalian priest. And I said, who's a woman, by the way, and said, all right, I'm pagan. And I turned out to be the diversity person for them. They were so excited to have a pagan. Look, a pagan! Would you do an invocation for us? So I did. I did an invocation to Athena, you know. And so I'm finding that I need to be brave enough to speak my truth wherever I am. And that usually works out in people of spirit. That usually is something that's very welcomed.
Just as an extension of that question, I know you said you were raised Catholic initially. Family, your family, friends, any issues with them?
You know, I never really did come out to my family as pagan. I'm old enough now that my parents have moved on. My brothers, my generation know who I am. So I just didn't really bring it up. And I moved off of my birth family and have that intentional family that many of us do.
Yes.
It's not something I speak too much about at work, but I'm public and people do. And I work in the tech industry, so people Google me and find me. And then they start talking to me, which is great.
Wonderful. You know, I attended an interfaith seminary here in New York back in the 90s as part of my spiritual path. And we had people of every possible faith, belief system, ilk. And the wonderful thing about it is that the clergy who founded the school, which was a rabbi, a priest, an imam, and many others, never said anything negative about anyone. It was always embrace everything, embrace the all, because we're all part of that same wonderful, loving, cosmic energy. And no matter how that manifests for us in our personal path, we have to not only tolerate each other. Tolerance is not enough. You have to go beyond tolerance. You have to embrace and respect and love and learn, because in learning you find that there's more in common than there is in difference.
Oh, that's lovely. And I'm so glad that you had that experience. And I find that true, too, in interfaith work. I was at the Parliament of the World's Religions in 1993, so it might have been around there, when we all signed a compact, right? The religions who were represented there agreed that we would stop going to war with each other. It hasn't really had an effect. There are still religious wars, but we do have that agreement. We do have that aspiration. And I find that that's really important, especially as I talk about this work. We're talking about an ancient tradition that was closed down by another religion. But we don't bring that conflict forward in time. I work with Christians. There are Christians who do work in theurgy, and they move in and out of theurgy. So it's important to keep the conflict in the past, to recognize that it happened, but to move forward and to connect with other people of spirit. I think it's absolutely true what you said.
I think this, our world, and this is our world, it's not their world or your world or my world, it's our world. I think our world needs to further embrace rather than reject each person's individual faith and belief and recognize that all paths lead to the same place ultimately, and that place is this great, wonderful, loving energy that put us here to begin with. And if we can look beyond the bigotry and look beyond the preconceived notions and look beyond anything that would inhibit us from fully embracing each other as brother and sister, then we achieve, I think, what every foundational faith and belief system had in mind, the oneness of all.
Yes, I think that's absolutely true. And it's important to remember at this moment when there's this big surge in the country, in the United States, against a specific religion, against Islam. And I hear that echoing in the magical community. You know, I'm not sure that it's not a good idea to deport all Muslims. And I have to say, this is counter to the experience of connecting in spirit with other people. And it's also counter to our own best interests when we begin to divide and decide that one path is better than another path. We're also going under that same bus. There's nothing that protects us from that kind of discrimination, too.
Absolutely. My guest this evening is Brandy Williams, author of the brand new Llewellyn book, For the Love of the Gods, The History and Modern Practice of Theurgy. Brandy, please tell our listeners where they can get your book and find out more about you.
You can get my book on Amazon. You can get my book at Llewellyn. You can also hit my website, BrandyWilliamsAuthor.com.
And we'll be back with Brandy Williams on Destination Unlimited on the OMTimes Radio Network after these messages.
You're listening to OTRFM, part of the IOM Radio Network.
Are you in an interfaith relationship and thinking of getting married? For 18 years, Reverend Lori Sue Brockway has been creating personalized, loving, and romantic ceremonies for couples of all faiths and cultural backgrounds. Reverend Lori Sue's sensitivity to the needs of interfaith couples is reflected in the compassionate and inclusive way she addresses the concerns of parents and families. Reverend Lori Sue is also the author of several best-selling books on interfaith weddings and wedding vows. Selected as one of the top interfaith officiants by New York Magazine, Reverend Lori Sue serves couples in the New York metropolitan area and beyond. Find out more at her website, yourinterfaithwedding.com.
Have you ever wondered how to change your love paradigm? The secret key is finding a love partnership, not just a regular connection. How do you find these? Through conscious relationships. Ascending Hearts Dating is a dating site for people like you that believes in second chances and a different type of spiritual connection. Try Ascending Hearts for free today at AscendingHearts.com and change your love paradigm. Ascending Hearts, the premier dating community for the spiritually awake.
Circle of Hearts Radio is a sanctuary on the airwaves. Join me, Grandmother Elia, in the circle on Sunday, 2 p.m. Eastern, as I share information to both enlighten and nourish your soul.
I want to thank my mommy for loving me so much.
For taking me to the doctor when I broke my foot.
For leaving me alone when I wanted to be alone.
And now, as a grown-up, I'm thankful for being able to take care of you, my dear mom. For taking you to your therapies. For understanding that sometimes you simply want to be alone.
Roles change without us noticing. That's why AARP gives you the information to provide even better care for your loved one. Visit aarp.org/caregiving. Brought to you by AARP and the Ad Council.
And we're back on Destination Unlimited. My guest this evening is Brandy Williams, author of For the Love of the Gods, The History and Modern Practice of Theurgy. So we're talking about theurgy before and what it means to love the gods. How does theurgy relate to other magical traditions?
Well, theurgy is the source of the Western tradition, Hermetic tradition, or what I call Western traditional magic. Witchcraft and ceremonial magic, Golden Dawn and Thelema, are all related to one another, and they rest on this foundation of theurgy. I talked about the experience of picking up the Greek magical papyri and realizing that I could understand it. And this is because it came down to us. These rituals passed through the city of Haran in Turkey and passed through Istanbul. and moved into the medieval grimoires, to the Lesser Key of Solomon and others, and then passed ritually into our traditions. And also the philosophy passed down through a different realm of transmission. So the theory passed down to us as well. So it's really foundational for what we do in the Western traditions.
Let's do a little definition for some of our listeners who are not familiar with some of the things that we just discussed. So let's start with the concept of the Lesser Key of Solomon. What is the Lesser Key of Solomon?
It's a book that was a medieval grimoire, a collection of ritual practices that that was translated by the Golden Dawn magicians, actually. These Victorian men and women hung out in the British Library and found stuff like this and translated it and then brought it into contemporary practice.
Now, the Golden Dawn, what was the Golden Dawn? What is the Golden Dawn? Because there's still a Golden Dawn.
Yeah, there are groups today that are practicing Golden Dawn magic. These were people, British Victorian magicians, they were women and men both, who put together the system that we call ritual magic today or ceremonial magic. So they built rituals that called Egyptian deities, actually. They were really very fond of the Egyptians. And they laid down a whole structure, a whole framework that we practice today. The rituals of witchcraft is a religion which is based in European folk magic, but the rituals come from this same ritual tradition. They were picked up and moved into that religion. And you would recognize, anyone who's a practicing witch or magician would recognize the rituals of the Golden Dawn as ancestral, and also recognize the rituals of the Greater Key of Solomon and Lesser Key of Solomon. We would recognize those as being part of our tradition. It's where we get our runes, where we get the idea of four quarters, making a circle that protects us. All of those things come from that specific source.
Now, you had mentioned Aleister Crowley and Thelema. What was that about?
Aleister Crowley was a Golden Dawn magician, and then he followed his own path. He was a man who had a direct experience with deity. He had the experience of having a book dictated to him that was spoken by three entities. We could call them gods: Nuit, Hadit, and Rahurquit. And that book, the Book of the Law, became the foundational book for an entire religious philosophy called Thelema. So Crowley really consciously practiced theurgy. He was a man who was read Greek, read Latin, read the classics, understood what he was seeing, and built those rituals into his system. So Thelema is very much a theurgic system. And Crowley, of course, he was a colorful character. he was called the wickedest man in the world, and there was a period of life where he really reveled in that. He really loved getting in people's faces. His clarion call to freedom was, "Do what thou wilt shall be the whole of the law." And he really meant that. He really exemplified that in his life. He did lots of things. In his later years, he kind of mellowed out and became maybe regretted some of the excesses of his youth, I think. But we definitely, people who hear Aleister Crowley and hear his name, think about this man, you know, who is very fierce and feisty and very much cut a swath across Europe.
And they used to refer to him as the Beast.
He loved calling himself the Beast, actually. Mm. This comes from Revelations. It's a vision. He did a series of visions, again, in a theurgic tradition. This one is Enochian, so it's in the ceremonial tradition. And he did a series of visions. And in one of the visions, another entity appeared to him, Babylon, from the Book of Revelations. And Babylon is this sort of repressed memory of goddesses in the West, and specifically goddesses associated with women's sexuality. And he really championed this. He said, okay, instead of this being a negative thing or an evil thing, it's a sacred thing. Women's sexuality is sacred, and I am the Beast. You know, Babylon was riding on the Beast in the Revelation, so he said, I'm the Beast she rides on, which mm-hmm. he meant it to be exactly as it sounds.
mm-hmm. You know, the whole concept of the feminine, divine, and sacred sexuality is very much part of our world today.
Yeah, I think so. And I really, what called me to Thelema was this sense of celebration of sexuality, that it is one of the things that drives our magical practice. It's one of the things that drives our spirituality. And it is, when you think about it, the gate of life. It's how we come into the world. So it really should be something that's sacred and not rejected or repressed.
Absolutely. Now, you'd also mentioned Ordo Templi Orientis. What was that? What is that?
Well, Aleister Crowley didn't create the Ordo Templi Orientis, but he definitely shaped it. It's a fraternal organization. By fraternal, we mean an organization in which people have bonds that we feel are like family. We say fraternal, and fraternal means male, but it's not in this case. OTO, Ordo Templi Orientis, is open to women and men, and people of all genders, I might add. There are trans people and intersex people as well. So it's an order in which you take initiation to join it. So there, it's kind of like a secret society. It comes off the Masons. There's some Masonic structure in the rituals as well.
And what about Wicca, the practice of Wicca?
Wicca is witchcraft was brought into the public by Gerald Gardner in England. And Gerald Gardner knew Aleister Crowley. He visited him in the last days of his life. That gave rise to all kinds of conspiracy ideas that Crowley wrote the Gardnerian rituals. He didn't. But as I said, they have a common source. So it's understandable that they look really similar. But Gerald Gardner brought witchcraft into light. It sort of rests on this understanding. I called it European folk religion, which is kind of an academic term, which means that people worshipped the gods and connected with nature across the European continent. And that makes its way into witchcraft, into Wiccan practice. So witchcraft is a little bit different from ceremonial magic because it really does have a much more pagan base. Ceremonial magic picks up some of the ideas of Christianity and Islam and Judaism and uses some of the symbol sets and uses the term God. So witches sometimes find it difficult to be ceremonial magicians because of that bar, but they are very, very similar traditions in terms of ritual.
Now, we know that in many of these practices, people can be solo or lone practitioners. Can theurgy be done alone, or do you need to be in a group?
No, actually, theurgy is set up so that you do it more or less by yourself. You might have one other person that you're working with as you call deity into each other. That's the classic way of practicing theurgy. So it's very much something that you can pick up a book and read and do. There are people who practice in groups. And as I mentioned, witchcraft and ceremonial groups are groups that do these operations. So if you are a witch or you're attracted to witchcraft or Golden Dawn magic or Thelemic magic, OTO, you will find that you can practice these rituals in groups. But classic traditional theurgy was something that was done by one or two people, and maybe a couple of people got together to read texts and say hymns to the gods. So it's a very quiet little personal practice.
And how does one begin the practice of theurgy?
There are so many good books available now, and it's really lovely that we're seeing a resurgence of interest in theurgy. You could put theurgy in your web browser, and you'll find the works of John Opsipaus. He's the person who I would think of as the foremost theurgist of our time, and he wrote web pages 20 years ago that were what got me started on my practice. So you can do that. You can read books. Llewellyn has a line of theurgic books, including, I think there's a For Beginners book, actually. So it's definitely something you can just pick up a book and begin to practice.
And can women practice theurgy, or is that, obviously you're doing it. So what about the women's practice of theurgy?
And it's a fair question too, because the ceremonial orders are, they do admit women, but they look and feel kind of like they center on men because they're Victorian and they have this really male language. And it's also a fair question, too, because the practice of philosophy that comes from Aristotle really closed women out of the idea of doing philosophy. Aristotle had this idea as a philosopher that women were incomplete men and their brains hadn't fully formed, so they couldn't think properly. So you don't really find women in Aristotelian philosophy. And what I think is really great about theurgy and about Platonic philosophy is that women have always been involved. Plato's mother was a philosopher. Plato was taught by women in his life. He taught women. And so all of the teachers you find have women in their circles. There are prominent women teachers. And I really love that about the tradition. It makes it very accessible.
What's fascinating is when you study ancient religions and practices, most of the leaders were priestesses.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's true. You do find a lot of women involved. Part of it is because women who push culture forward. We're the culture bearers, and so I think that's one of the places that you find that.
culture bearers in the sense that women were the storytellers. They were the ones who kept the history.
Yes, that's right. And taught it to the children. That's really fun. Actually, it's a nice thought as I tell stories of the theurgic teachers. It's nice to think of myself in that tradition.
Absolutely. It was the women who would, the verbal tradition before writing was around, and would share the stories. In fact, there was an amazing book written many years ago called The Alphabet Versus the Goddess that basically had the premise that prior to the alphabet, the written language, and it had to do with the fact that the chisel and hammer that were used for ancient writing, for doing writing in stone, changed the side of the brain from the feminine side of the brain to the masculine side of the brain, and that the goddess thrived prior to this shift in mentality.
You know, I'd forgotten about that book until you mentioned it, but it's a very interesting thought. And it's something that we find as stories began to be written down, they became fixed. So one of the things I like to say is that the gods are not the stories we tell about them. You hear about the Greek gods and you think, how can this be a being that I can look up to? And it's because, you know, it's a story that was told in a particular place and time, and it happens to be the one that we know, but there were other stories.
Absolutely. That book was called The Alphabet Versus the Goddess, written, I believe, by Leonard Schlain, if anyone is interested in getting a copy of that. My guest this evening is Brandy Williams. She's the author of the new Llewellyn book, For the Love of the Gods, The History and Modern Practice of Theurgy. And we'll be back with Brandy after these messages on the OMTimes Radio Network.
The number one reason girls drop out of school in sub-Saharan Africa is lack of access to feminine hygiene products. The Pads for Schoolgirls Project, an outreach of Humanity Healing International, is changing this paradigm by setting up sewing programs at schools, teaching girls a vocational skill, while producing the reusable pads that help keep them attending classes. The girls pay it forward by making and giving pad kits to other girls in need. To learn more, visit humanityhealing.org. Humanity Healing is where your heart is.
Hi, this is Sylvia Henderson, intuitive life coach and energy healer. Are you ready to elevate and rise way above your normal? Be sure to listen to my show, Intuitive Transformations, on OMTimes Radio, Sunday evenings at 9 p.m. Eastern. Get the inspiration you need to transform your life.
This is Terry Van Horn, and I want to invite you to join me for my weekly radio show, Healing Light, on OMTimes Radio, every Wednesday at 6 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. On Healing Light, we want to bring love, light, and blessings into your world. You can find out more about us at www.healinglightonline.com. Blessings.
When I was little, I didn't talk for a long time. I was sensitive to lights and sounds, so I built secret hiding places where they couldn't get in. Sometimes, I do the same things over and over, until one day, I found out I had autism. My family got me help. Slowly, I learned how to live with it better.
Early intervention can make a lifetime of difference. Learn the signs at autismspeaks.org/signs. Brought to you by Autism Speaks and the Ad Council.
You're listening to OTR-FM, part of the IOM Radio Network.
And we're back on Destination Unlimited. My guest is Brandy Williams, author of the new book, For the Love of the Gods, The History and Modern Practice of Theurgy. So is Theurgy a European tradition, or does it include people of color and different races?
And that's also a fair question, because it looks very white. It looks very much like a European tradition because it comes through Greece and because the people who practice it, like ceremonial magicians, trend in the European culture. But the tradition itself roots in Egypt. It comes from Kemet, and it comes through Greece, but you can see in Platonic philosophy an echo of the great wisdom of Egypt and of the great universities there. And it's important to me that we acknowledge this, that our tradition roots in Egypt, because it's something that we've kind of glorified the Greek culture, and we've said this is the dawn of civilization. This is where we get our great ideas, and the great ideas actually came from Africa and from Black people. So I really love calling this out, and I think too that this should be a tradition that can be accessible to people of color for that exact reason. And then the other place it comes from is India. This is a very interesting connection. So there was a philosopher, Pythagoras, who visited India and returned to Greece. And you can see, and he lived before Plato, so it was some years before Plato. And you can see the influence of Pythagoras and everything that happened subsequently. The idea of reincarnation enters Greek religion. It wasn't there before. It doesn't come from Egypt. Egypt didn't really have the idea of reincarnation. If you study that religion, they're all about... they're all about preserving the body so that it can serve as a foundation for the soul's travels. But the idea that you leave this body and move from one body to another body, that comes from India, and it comes into the tradition right at that moment from Pythagoras. And then he was great too. Go ahead.
I'm sorry, please.
He was great too, because he recognized that you can't just teach men. It's one of the reasons that women are in this tradition. He said, if you're going to live a philosophical life, you have to live it with the family as a base, and that means we have to teach women as well. So he was the person who began to bring women into his circles, and the whole family would work together. And he actually tried to reform the Greek men and say, don't go off and have all of these women on the side. Cleave to your wife. So he had a very family-centered, family-values kind of philosophy, and it comes down through Platonism today.
And of course, in the Hindu tradition, we have that entire pantheon of gods and goddesses who represent many of the aspects of human life and are worshipped as such. The goddess Lakshmi for prosperity and beauty, and the comforts of the home. The goddess Saraswati for arts and music, etc., etc. And the Bhagavad Gita, the wonderful Hindu work, the Bhagavad Gita, talks about the relationship, the revelation between a god and a humanity. And so all of those traditions are certainly sources and foundations for the work of Theurgy.
Yes, and you find scholars who are looking at the Upanishads and finding the parallel ideas in Platonic philosophy. So you can really see the transmission. But I really love talking about the Hindu religious practice as well, because it highlights something that really fell out of our tradition for the exact reason that it was suppressed. And that's temple worship, the idea that you put a statue into a temple. And you find in Hindu religion today the operation of making that statue alive, of bringing that statue into being as a house for the deity. This was something that was done in Egypt, and it's something that was done by theurgists. And this was the exact thing that fell out of our practice. And it is not in our practice today. We didn't get through the ritual system. We didn't get, here's how you bring a deity into a statue. So that's something that we're reviving in the contemporary world. And we can look at those Hindu temples and that practice and begin to understand how it might have worked for us. And we might be able to do it today.
For those who have never done so, find a Hindu temple in your area. All people are welcome to the puja, which is the worship service, and you'll find it absolutely fascinating. We have this concept, those of us who never had attended a puja or been to a true Hindu temple, of the people sitting and oming and meditating and so on. That's absolutely nothing to do with Hindu religious practice. A Hindu temple is one of the most frenetic and noisy places I've ever been to. And what they're doing basically is they're dressing and respecting and treating the murti, the deity, the representation of the deity. And in doing so, what they're trying to do is bring the aspects of the deity, whatever the deity represents, and bring that into their home and into their personal lives. And it's absolutely beautiful.
It is. And Theurgy is exactly that in the West. So we bring the deities into ourselves and channel the deities. And we also bring the deities into statues. So we bring them into the world, into physical being, so that we can relate to them. And that's really the core of the practice.
I've been familiar with ceremonial magic and pagan practice most of my life, but I've only heard about Theurgy relatively recently. Is that the reason why it's so popular, because it's a personalization of the practice?
I think so. And I think there are people who have begun to bring theurgy forward. We knew the practices. We've only recently begun to connect them up with the Platonic heritage, which is one reason I really wanted to write this book and bring that forward. And there are a couple of people actually that have helped to bring theurgy into the contemporary world. There's my editor, Alicia Gallo at Llewellyn. She very much wants to do serious magical books, and theurgy is about as serious as it comes. So she's bringing out a number of books. A number of people have been writing for her. There's Tony Merzwicki and Bruce McLennan. He wrote The Wisdom of Hypatia. If you read one book besides mine about theurgy, read The Wisdom of Hypatia. It's just a lovely, lovely book. And then there's another press, Avalonia Press in England with Sarita Desta. She is bringing out specifically theurgic works. And there's a third person who's been very important to this revival, Glenn Turner, who does a big convention called Pantheacon. In 2010, she walked around Pantheacon and said, you know, I'm seeing a lot of things about theurgy and I'd like to pull that out. So she made another conference that was just a symposium on theurgy that brought a bunch of us together to talk to each other and kind of start to build relationships and spark ideas off each other. So really this sort of contemporary resurgence in theurgy owes its existence to three really powerful women, which I love.
Wonderful. Now, you mentioned Plato, you mentioned the Hermetica, you mentioned all of these philosophies. Now, people think a philosophy is something that's a difficult thing to learn or study. Is there a lot of study involved in learning theurgy?
It helps to read, for certainly. But you know, when we say philosophy, I almost wanted to use another word because we think of something really different. We think of philosophy as being people talking about ethical quandaries, right? Or talking about something that's really intellectual and not grounded.
Abstract concepts, yeah.
Abstract concepts, yeah. And the Platonic philosophers, they were interested in how the world worked, but they very much grounded that in how people relate to each other, and specifically in how we relate to the gods, how the universe, how the gods move the universe, and how we relate to that. So it's much, much more about a religious understanding. So you can learn it. It's always best to do your own reading rather than let someone else read and explain to you. But that said, you can pick up one or two books and begin to do this practice. So I want to encourage people to just learn themselves about the ritual practices and do as much of the philosophy as you are called to do.
Now, like many things drawn from ancient times, we learn most about them from the myths and the stories, and you have some wonderful stories in For the Love of the Gods. How did you choose those stories?
Boy, that was really hard, too, because there's a chain of philosophers, it's called the Golden Chain, that academics recognize as passing Platonic philosophy forward. And there's only really one woman in it, Hypatia, but there were so many women who practiced and so many other kinds of people who practiced. I really wanted to bring that out. So I looked for stories that really called to me, and there were people who should have had their own stories, but I had only a limited amount of time, right? So I picked the ones really that I thought exemplified some way that theurgy was practiced. It's important to talk about the Egyptian priestesses, as you mentioned. It's important to talk about Plato. It's important to talk about Plotinus because he was the first person after Plato to move it forward. And then who was it who was important? You know, who was it who moved the system forward? And what gets interesting, too, is that after the close of the temples, the Roman emperors closed the temples, the philosophy continued. So it passed from person to person. And I pulled a couple of those stories out to ground us in understanding we do have a connection to the past all the way through from today back to Plato.
Now, you talked about Plotinus earlier in the show. What else are your favorite? What's another one of your favorite stories?
Oh, I love Geber. And the reason was that I set his story in Haran, the city in Turkey. Few people know that there was a pagan city in the Mediterranean region that was extant in the 12th century, right? It closed in the 12th century. There was a city of the moon god and a temple that was still there. So I got to, for a brief moment in time, I got to walk the streets of Haran and look up at the temple of the moon god and watch women go and make cakes and go take them to the temple. And that's very, very close to us in time. So I really loved that moment.
What's the most difficult thing about learning an ancient magical system?
Well, that there aren't really people who are practicing it today. That is, there are ceremonial magicians and there are witches, but the open pagan temples are not, you know, I can't go down the street to the temple of Athena and go talk to Athena there.
Why not?
Yeah, I know. Well, actually, there's one in Nashville. I have a life desire to go see the temple in Nashville, and pagan groups have actually gone and made offerings to that Athena there. Right. But yeah, so it's harder. I didn't get taught this by my parents. I have to learn this on my own and from other people. And I think that though you see, it's becoming really popular. I mean, people are talking about, we have a chance now to really bring pagan religion back in a way that we haven't seen it in public in 2000 years. And that's a very exciting time to live in.
And what would you like your readers to take away from For the Love of the Gods?
That the gods are approachable, that you can sincerely bring yourself to that relationship and the gods will move into your life. And that relationship, while I'm intellectual and I talk about arriving there through the study of intellectual practices and ritual practices, it's really based in the heart. This is something the tradition insists on, that you're not just thinking about it or thinking about what you can get from the gods, but that there is a love that goes from you to the gods and a love that goes from the gods to you. And that's the most important part of the practice.
Connecting the heart with the head is the true foundation of any really beautiful faith. And thank you so much, Brandy Williams, for sharing with us her book, For the Love of the Gods, The History and Modern Practice of Theurgy. Please tell our listeners one more time how they can find out about your book and more about you.
You can go to brandywilliamsauthor.com to read to learn more about me and where I'm going to be appearing. And you can also contact Llewellyn, and you can find my books on Amazon.
Brandy, thank you so much for joining us. This has been an absolute pleasure.
Thank you.
And thank you for listening to us tonight. I'm Victor the Voice Furman. This is Destination Unlimited on the OMTimes Radio Network. Thanks for joining us and have a great week.